Hello, First Church family and friends, and welcome to worship. And welcome to this second Sunday of Advent. That word Advent, just in a general sense, means the arrival of something important or someone important. And just as we might prepare for a big event in our lives or the arrival of an important guest, so too we prepare for Christ to come into our lives. And this is not just about preparing with lights and decorating, baking, or gift giving. This is a spiritual preparation of the heart, that we make space in our hearts and in our minds for Christ to come and be our Lord and Savior. And so let us begin our time of worship. Let us continue preparing for Christ to come to us as we begin worship and sing together, "Come, thou long expected Jesus." So God bless you as we worship.
Our feet. Good morning, First Church. This is Pastor Cesar. The first scripture reading from today is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 46 through 56. Again, the Gospel of Luke, New Testament, chapter 1, verses 46 to 56. And the Word of God says, "And Mary said, 'My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scared those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors.' Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home." This is the Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, my friend, please close your eyes and let us pray together on this day. Dear God, we give you thanks, Lord, for your word. Father, this is the second Sunday of Advent. We find hope in our relationship with you as we put our hope and trust in you. Your word promised us that we will be filled completely with joy and peace, and we believe that. This hope will not be an empty wish, but a hope that has ingredient and great confidence through the power of your Holy Spirit that lives in those who believe. Father, thank you for understanding us and loving us just as we are. And thank you for accepting us even when we feel hopeless, even when we make mistakes. Father, teach us how to find satisfaction even if our situations remain the same or worse. With your perspective and guidance, we can push all the impossible and find the strength and courage to believe that no matter what happens, Lord, your hope will lift us to a higher place where joy and purpose reign again and we feel confident in you. Father, in this morning, we align our hearts with the truth that Jesus taught, and we receive hope from you, just from you, our God, our Creator, our Redeemer. Fill our hearts full with hope today and allow us to be an encouragement to those around us who are hopeless. And together, we pray that prayer that you taught us to say. Our Lord who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into the temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. God bless you all.
I remember as a kid being in a living room. I don't know if it was at home or my grandparents or somewhere else, but the evening news was on. And I distinctly remember hearing a voice of an adult first sigh and then say, "Man, the world is going to hell in a handbasket." Now, I don't really understand that whole handbasket thing, although it might stem from an old piece of stained glass that had images of devils carrying people off in push carts. I know that sounds really creepy, But however that phrase came about, it's been around for quite some time, and it's used to express a certain amount of worry or despair or judgment or frustration with how things are going in the world, that things aren't headed in the right direction. Certainly, I have felt that. No doubt this year seems to have offered a lot of fodder for us to be perhaps saying that very phrase. As a matter of fact, on a lighter note, I saw an ad this week for a dating company called Match.com, and it was about the devil being matched up with the year 2020. It's really quite humorous if you get a chance to see it, but nevertheless, all kidding aside, that phrase I have always pushed back against, though. I'm not a fan of that phrase, because underneath that phrase are some pretty strong theological underpinnings that I just don't agree with. If we were to say that there was truth in that phrase, that the world's going to hell in a handbasket, then what we're really saying is that God has given up on us. What we're saying is that God doesn't care, that God's not showing up anymore, and that God isn't going to get involved. And that's just not what Advent and Christmas is about at all. It certainly wasn't what Jesus' ministry was about. It isn't what he taught. So let's listen to some of what he taught from Matthew chapter 5, the first 12 verses. Hear this word of the Lord. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now this passage begins, before we get into all that Jesus is declaring, this passage begins with this: when Jesus saw the crowds. When Jesus saw the crowds, who do you suppose he saw? Who was there in those crowds? Just imagine, if you will, what their life circumstances might be. It might not be too hard to have that kind of imagination. Suppose he saw a farmer who has had taxes so high that his land is now starting to get whittled away to pay those taxes, and he has less and less ability to grow crops and sustain his family. Or perhaps in that crowd, there's a grieving woman without a husband and without a son to protect her in that day and age. Perhaps there was a fisherman who just had such a bad round of luck out on the lake, and just the thought of getting back out and casting those nets again to catch nothing was more than he could imagine. Perhaps there were everyday faithful Jews who were trying their best to follow all the rules, but always ended up feeling inadequate and unloved and judged by the system. Perhaps there were people who were taken advantage of in that crowd. Maybe the people in those crowds could understand our turn of phrase that I started this message with. Maybe they could feel that seeming demise of the world themselves. Maybe they were wondering, how did things get to be so hard? How did things get to be so messed up? Maybe they struggled in their faith, wondering when things would change. Maybe they were people who had forgotten what hope was really all about. Maybe for them, hope had dwindled to nothing more than wishful thinking. Now, I think about that, and we use that word hope very broadly, and we might mean really wishful thinking, but wishful thinking, in my understanding, is an almost hope. And it's used for anything. We hope, perhaps, for something in particular for Christmas under the tree. We hope, or we have wishful thinking for our favorite ball team to win the next game. We even might just sit back and have wishful thinking that the world might change. If I just wish it enough, that it will change out there. But that's an almost hope. What would it take? What would it look like if we moved from an almost hope to an altogether hope? What is that altogether hope? Well, I think an altogether hope is an assurance that comes from deep within us that we find exhibited both by Mary and by Jesus, this deep well of trust and assurance in God the Father to be with them. It's not a wishful thinking, but this something more that is within the human spirit, this trust that God will act. Mary proclaims that very, or experiences that very deep hope, that altogether hope in that poem that is attributed to her, the Magnificat that Pastor Caesar read. And she proclaimed that the mighty are brought down from their thrones and the lowly are lifted up. Now, she proclaims that even though King Herod, the mighty King Herod, who was going to be after her child that she has yet to give birth to, he's still on his throne. He's still in power. And he will still be in power when Jesus is born. But Mary has this such deep assurance that what God is doing in Jesus does bring down the mighty from their thrones and lifts up the lowly. And altogether hope is like this deep trust that Jesus had that helped him to declare the very things to those crowds that we hold near and dear to our hearts, like, blessed are you if you are poor in spirit. The kingdom of heaven is yours, is yours. It is yours. Blessed are you if you're mourning. Oh, and it's a horrible feeling to mourn, but blessed are you, for you will be comforted. It's not this wishful thinking. It is an assurance. It is a declaration that it will happen. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are you, even if people despise you because of the faith. Rejoice and be glad in that day. For yours is the kingdom of heaven. That is a deep assurance. That is an altogether hope, an altogether hope that God is not done. That God hasn't given up on us. Peter declared it. In one of his letters, the Apostle Peter, he wrote that God is not slow in as we might think God is slow. We might think, well, wait a minute, where is God? What is God doing? Why isn't God showing up? No, no, no. Peter says God is not slow as we might think, but God is patient, wanting everyone to come to repentance. God is at work, drawing people to that place of repentance. And why? Because God loves us. Altogether, hope is that deep assurance that God's purpose has not been to come into the world and condemn the world. That's exactly what Jesus said to Nicodemus late at night. In the Gospel of John, we hear, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." And then the next verse, which is so important for us to remember, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." God's not done. That's what it means to have an altogether hope, that God hasn't given up on us. An altogether hope is the deep assurance that the future is a victory won already by Jesus. Jesus even declared it before he even headed to the cross. He said, "In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world." An altogether hope is not just this deep assurance, though, that God's work, but it is also the heart that looks out and rejoices at the places and the people and the work of God in the world. It is an altogether hope is able to see how God is acting, where God is acting in the world. An altogether hope has eyes that can see, a heart that has turned to the Lord. An altogether hope is the heart that sees humility and repentance as the way to prepare for Christ. An altogether hope can look out on the world and not despair. Even where there is affliction, even where there's conflict, but rather can look out and see the possibilities for God's kingdom to come into the world as it is in heaven. That's what it means to have an altogether hope. Is that those places of brokenness are opportunities for God's wholeness to come in. An altogether hope shares food with the hungry. An altogether hope visits those who are lonely. An altogether hope holds on, helps others, shares love. An altogether hope is lived out as generosity. An altogether hope is lived out as people do to others as they would have others do to them. An altogether hope listens to the news or reads the paper and does not scoff, but rather prays. An altogether hope sees the other or the enemy and extends the hand of fellowship. An altogether hope turns the world on its head, just as Jesus declared, just as Mary proclaimed, turns it all around, where the mighty are brought low and the lowly are brought up, where those who are mourning are comforted, those who are meek are inheritors of the world. An altogether hope turns that all around and doesn't just let the world go off in a handbasket. We are preparing for the arrival of our Savior here and now, today, this moment. We are preparing. He is arriving. Every day, he's showing up. Every day, he's knocking on the door of our hearts. Every day, he's coming in to see what can be done. We prepare for Christ by having an altogether hope that Jesus' arrival is not in vain. So let us light the next Advent candle and let us move our hearts from an almost hope to an altogether hope. God bless you.
With the fire of the peace candle already among us, we remember that over 2,000 years ago, hope showed up in a baby, the best symbol of hope there is. Hope was laid in a manger, literally a feeding trough, a sign that generations could be sustained from this hope. God showed up in the last place anyone would choose, showing us that no place on earth is beyond hope's reach. But hope doesn't remain still. Hope travels. When one person gets it, a string of others catch it until we can envision the well-being of the whole world. And so we light the second candle on the Advent wreath as we hear Peter declare, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. May you move from an almost hope to an altogether hope through the presence of God that is everywhere and for everyone."
As we come to the time of our offering, I want to lift up an important ministry here at First Church, which is our music ministry. And today I want to celebrate the choir. The choir has continued to join their voices, although they're not in the same room, and be able to bring us some beautiful music to enhance our worship time. And so as we come and listen to our offering piece today, thank you for your support that helps make this ministry continue to be possible through these days. And the song that you're going to hear today is one of the pieces that the choir has been working on for the cantata next week. So God bless you. come to the end of our worship service today, a few announcements. First of all, we will have communion via a Zoom meeting at 11:15. Please join us. You can find the link in your e-news. And the next thing is that Santa's Wonderland is going to be here before we know it next Saturday. And as we prepare to welcome the community for a special drive through Santa's Wonderland, it's not too late to jump in and help. If you're interested in being a part of one of those friendly faces of First Church to welcome the community, please send Karen Klaus an email. And then the next day, on Sunday, December 13th, is the choir cantata. Please be sure to mark out either 4 o'clock or 7 o'clock as a time for you and your family or friends to gather together and enjoy this special music together and enhance your time of preparation of Christ coming to us. And so now, let us go forth continuing to invite and prepare for Christ in our lives. Let us go into this week not expecting despair to be our future, but that our future is with God. And let us go forth into this week with the promise of hope. Let it rest in our hearts. Let it grow within our lives. And may we share that hope. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God bless you and see you next week.